Okay, good afternoon, everyone. It's Rabbi Akiva Mails, and I hope that you're well. Today is Wednesday. It is the 23rd of February, and we're getting ready for Parshas Vayakhel, the Shabbos. I want to share some Divrei Torah with you that I think you'll appreciate and will enhance our understanding of the Parsha. I want to preface this by saying sometimes Vayakhel could be a little bit challenging, because there are four parshios that have to do with the construction of the Mishkan. There was Truma and Tetzaveh, and there is Vayakhel and Pekudei. In years where it's not a leap year, then what happens? Where it's not a leap year, Truma and Tetzaveh are combined, and Vayakhel and Pekudei are combined. So you end up that there's only two parshios that you have to find Divrei Torah on that have to do with the construction of the Mishkan. But a year like this, where we have an extra month of Adar, there are four parshios. Truma, Tetzaveh, Vayakhel, Pekudei, where you've got to keep finding stuff about the construction of the Mishkan. And some people get very nervous. They're, what am I going to do? But I want to assure you to have no fear, because the Torah is so vast and there are so many Mefarshim, there are so many wonderful commentaries. There is no shortage of material. So even if the subject matter for 4 weeks has to deal with the construction of the Mishkan, rest assured that there are worthy Divrei Torah to be found, and there is always something new to be found. And God willing, I want to share that with you this year. Now, what I want to share with you today, we're going to start off with, we're going to share three different thoughts today. The first one is I'm very excited about, because had I seen something which I had seen this week on the Parsha, I would have said, Dayenu, it's enough. That's very cool. But here's where it gets fascinating, is that last Shabbos, Leila and I were away, and I'm sorry we weren't able to give the Parsha Shir last Wednesday because we were traveling. But last Shabbos, we were away. We spent Shabbos with our sister-in-law and brother-in-law and family in Far Rockaway, New York. And while there, the rabbi spoke about something that relates to exactly what I found on the Parsha. I'm going to share that with you too. I thought this was incredible. We'll get to that in a minute. So let's see. Parshas Vayakhel begins. We've got the opening psukim right here. So it's Perek Lamed Hei. That's chapter 35. Then we're going to look at the first pasuk and then the fourth pasuk. You'll see why. So the first pasuk says, Vayakhel Moshe es kol adas b'nei Yisrael. That Moshe called forward, he gathered all the members of B'nai Yisrael, the Jewish people, Vayomer Aleihem, and he said to them, Ela advarim asher tziva Hashem lasos osam. These are the things that the Lord has commanded you to make. And then let's go a little further to verse 4, Dalet. Vayomer Moshe al kol adas B'nai Yisrael lemor. Moshe says to everybody, saying, Ze adavar, these are the words asher tziva Hashem lemor that God has commanded to say, and he goes forward. Okay. What does this have to do with what I want to share? Let's look at one more pasuk. It's the beginning of next week's parsha, Pekudei. Ela Pekudei HaMishkan. These are the numbers, the accounting of the Mishkan. Next week's going to go through an accounting of all the items that went into the construction, donated, and then were used for the construction of the Mishkan. Mishkan HaEdus. This was the Mishkan, the tabernacle of testimony, of Edus, testimony, Asher Pukad Al Pi Moshe, which were counted at the command of Moshe. Avodas HaLevim, this was the work of the Levim, Biyadi Samar, under the direction of Itamar, Ben Aaron HaKohen, was the son of Aaron the Kohen. So Rashi quotes the Medrash Tanchuma, why is the Mishkan known as the Mishkan HaEdus, the Mishkan, the tabernacle of testimony? So look what Rashi says, quoting the Midrash. Edus li Yisrael, the Mishkan was testimony to the Jewish people, Sheviter lam HaKadosh Baruch Hu al Maisa Egel, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that God Almighty forgave them for the terrible crime, that incident of the golden calf. What a terrible sin. But the Mishkan served as edus, as testimony that Hashem forgave us for that. How? Shaharei Hishra Shechina So B'neihem. Because by the existence of the Mishkan, after it was constructed, God's presence comes to dwell there. There's no way God's presence would have dwelled amongst us had he decided to discard us. So the fact that God's presence resided amongst us, there was Hashras Hashchina, God's presence dwelt with us, that was testimony that we had been forgiven for the sin of the golden calf. That's why the Mishkan is referred to as Mishkan Ho'edus, the tabernacle of testimony. Let me just make a bracha. Bracha Torah Nei Leinu Ma'achulam Shachun Yavirom. Thanks. So that's what Rashi's telling us. The Mishkan is called the Mishkan HaEdus, the Mishkan of testimony, because its very existence, anyone would look and see God's presence was dwelling there. That serves as a testimony in our midst. If God's in our midst, that means he has forgiven us for the construction, that great sin of the golden calf. So what do we see? We have this principle that the Mishkan was a kapara. The Mishkan was a means of atoning for the sin of the golden calf. You clearly see that in this Midrash because it's called the Mishkan HaEdus. So the question that we're going to deal with the first part of today's shiur is going to be how, what about the Mishkan particularly makes it a kapara, so to say, offsets the sin of the golden calf. So I want to first share with you what I found on this. It says as follows. It says, this is from the Sefer Torah Ladas, from Rav Matas Blum Zichrono Levracha. So Rav Matas Blum brings down as follows. Vayakel Moshe es kol hadas b'nei Yisrael. This is the opening pasuk in Vayakel. And Moshe gathers all the people of Israel. Vayomer aleihem, he says to them, Ela dvarim asher tzivah Hashem lasos asam. This is what God commanded you to make. This is what you need to do for the building of the Mishkan. Okay. Hagon Rav Shlomo Kluger. He's quoting Rav Shlomo Kluger. If you remember a couple weeks ago, we said over an incredible story about the backstory, the origins of Rav Shlomo Kluger that we saw in the Chafetz Chaim. And he says, incredible story about how the Dubna Magid basically had found him as a young orphan and had raised him. Rav Shlomo Kluger, the great Gon, that great sage, Rav Shlomo Kluger, was a product of incredible chesed because the Dubna Magid had taken him in. Absolutely wild. So he's going to quote something from Rav Shlomo Kluger here. I go to Rav Shlomo Kluger Zetzal. Rav Shlomo Kluger of blessed memory writes as follows. Kasav, he writes, Shatoro Meres Lashon Vayakel. Why here, when Moshe's gathering the Jewish people, of all the words you could use for gather, why did it choose the word Vayakel? When we're discussing the construction of the Mishkan, it could have been Vayasifu, that he gathered them. Why Vayakel? So look what he writes. Rav Shlomo Kluger says, "Why Vayakel? Kivan shamishkan hu kapara al chereigel." The whole point of the Mishkan was to offset, was to be a kapara, was to atone for what had occurred at the egel. And here there's a hint. The Sham Nemar, by the construction of the egel azav, the golden calf, what did it say? Vayakel ha'am al Aaron. Everybody gathered and ganged up on Aaron. The term Vayakel was used. So as again, if the whole point of the Mishkan is the Mishkan HaEdus is to serve as testimony that we've been forgiven for what happened in the Egel. There's got to be inherent within the commands and the descriptions of the Mishkan. There are going to be some terms being used that we've seen before. And these are being used, these terms are used as a tikkun, as a way to be metaken, as a way to correct the poor usage of these terms in the sin of the golden calf. Now we're going to use those same terms in the correct way to see that it's being corrected. So that's where Shlomo Kluger's first point. This term Vayakel is a very, this is not a common term. Where else was it used? By the building of the golden calf. So now it makes sense. Moshe uses the term Vayakel. Now we're going to do Vayakel right. You used Vayakel the first time by the golden calf, which was a terrible chait. Now we're going to do a Vayakel for the good reasons for building the Mishkan. So that's the first point he says. In order to atone for that everybody ganged up and gathered against Aaron to build the Mishkan, to build the Egel Azav, Memar, that's why now by the construction of Mishkan, it says Vayakel Moshe. Moshe gathered everybody about the construction of the Mishkan, but again, that term Vayakel was used. It's no accident. And now he says the second idea. Look, he says, that's why Moshe also used the term Dvarim. These are the words, and also Zeha Davar in Pasuk Dalet 4. Let's just go back up to the top of the page. Look in Pasuk Aleph. Pasuk Aleph said, Vayakel Moshe is called Aspenei Yisrael. Moshe gathers them, and Vayomer Alem, he says to them, Ela Hadvarim, these are the items, these are the matters, Asher Tziva Hashem La'asosusam. It's no accident he uses the word Hadvarim, and in the next Pasuk I have there, which is Pasuk Dalet, it says, Moshe says, Zeha Davar, these are the words. Where's that coming from? So Rav Shlomo Kluger says that's also no accident. Let's look back at Torah Ladas. He says, that's why the term is used here, Ela Hadvarim, and also Zeh Davar. Ki gam zehu lechaper al ma'ase egel. That's also atoning for some words and so for something that went on by the building of the golden calf. Shechatu ba'amram, the Jewish people sinned when they said, Ela Elohecha Yisrael. They said, Eileh, these are your gods, O Jewish people. So the word Eileh, that's why Moshe says, Eileh HaDvarim, these are the items that you need to build. It's no accident that Moshe used Eileh. And then when he says Zeh HaDavar, this is the words that Hashem said, because B'chein Bamram, what did they say? Zeh Moshe Ha'ish. Oh, that man Moshe is no longer here. Uche'es tike Moshe es kol ha-diburim asher chatu ben. Moshe was going out of his way here. He says, I know what words were articulated at the building of the golden calf. And we need to be mesakein those words. We have to use those words correctly now. Those words had, they were somehow or another involved with chet. They were involved in a great sin. So we now want to use them correctly for a dvar mitzvah. So Moshe's using these words very carefully, saying that what can I do to redeem those words, so to say, to elevate them? I don't want them to be associated with chet. I don't want those words, but the word vayakel. I don't want the word eila. I don't want the word zeh to be associated with the great chet. So now I'm going to use those words for a lofty purpose. I'm going to go ahead and use them for a great mitzvah. And that's no accident. That's what Rav Shlomo Kluger says. I think it's a beautiful idea just to get from this, is that we all make mistakes. We all make poor decisions at some points in our lives, and we're involved in chet. Besides all the tshuva that we want to do, and we want to return, we want to stop doing whatever it was, bad decision, bad choice, whatever it was that we did, we want to stop that. Of course we want to stop that. But if we really want to be metakin, we want to go ahead and correct it, we have to find some way to take the same words, the same actions, the same, let's say I used my hands to do an avera. How can I use my hands to do a mitzvah? You see this in Tefillah Zaka before Yom Kippur. It says all the time there, it says, you know, that I used, God, you gave me this incredible limb and it was supposed to be used for this and I used it for an avera. You gave me my legs and I should have run to a dvar mitzvah. I used them for an avera. You gave me my hands. I should have used them for this. I used them for that. You gave me my eyes. They should have been used to reading Torah and stuff, and I use them for sin. You gave me my tongue. I should have been using them for speaking Torah. I use them for speaking Lashon Hara. So if we want to do a tikkun, not only do I need to stop doing what I've done wrong, but I also need to take the tools that were used to do the wrong and now do something right with them. So I always apply that to, let's say, again, our body parts. I use my hands to steal, I use my legs to run to do evil, so now I got to use them to do a mitzvah. So it's the same idea. It's not just our hands, it's not just our limbs, but even our words. If I use, that's what Rosh Shlomo Kluger is saying, the term vayakel, the Jewish people use that for the chet ha'egel. The term zeh, the term eileh, they use these. So Moshe says, not only are we going to do tshuva on what happened, but we're going to redeem those words and use them for something positive. That's what's going on here. I looked at that and I said, wow, that was very, very interesting. And if it's all I would have seen, I would have said Dayenu. But as I said, last Shabbos, Leila and I were in Far Rockaway. And when we were in Far Rockaway, I davened with my brother-in-law. We davened at the Aguda there, Aguda of Long Island, that's in Far Rockaway. And the Rav there, Rav Meir Bronstein, he said something so beautifully, and it relates to this. After I saw this from Rav Shlomo Kluger, I said, oh my gosh, this is so similar to what Rav Bronstein was speaking about. So I got in touch with him. I emailed him the other day, and I asked him to help me find the source of something he said. He took pictures of it and sent it to me. I want to share this idea with you because it's beautiful. This idea that Rashi mentions at the beginning of Pekudei, that the Mishkan HaEdus, that the Mishkan is coming to atone and to show that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has forgiven us because we have the Shechina in our midst. And then we saw Rav Shlomo Kluger who says that it's a kapara, that it acts as a form of an atonement for it. So the question could easily be raised, saying that what is it about the Mishkan that makes things, that makes everything such an atonement? This is something which could erase. And that's what we're going to take a look at here. We're going to try to see what is it specifically about the Mishkan which acts as a kapara to the chet ha'egel. So Rabbi Bronstein said something beautiful, but before I share it with you, we need a little bit of background. I'm going to page 2. There's a very famous idea in the Medrash Tanhuma. You'll find it in some other places as well. But when I was looking around, I found the clearest in the Tanhuma. I think this will be the background, what we're going to need to share with you this beautiful idea that Rabbi Bronstein shared. So let's go. The Tanhuma, the Medrash Tanhuma is found in Pekudei, and I've got it on page 2. He's going to go through the timeline of when the Mishkan was built and what we could learn from this. So the Medrash says as follows: Ve'emosai nemar lo l'Moshe lasus es ha-Mishkan. When was Moshe told by God to start building the Mishkan? The Yom Kippurim. It was on Yom Kippur. Lefisha ala Moshe lar shalosh pa'amim. Moshe ascended Har Sinai three times. Vasa sham me'av esrim yom. He spent 120 days up on Har Sinai. Mishisha b'Sivan, the sixth of Sivan, that's Shavuos. That's when Moshe went initially to receive the Luchos. Shalosh sham ad Yom Kippurim. And he was up there until the 120 days, until Yom Kippur, Shu'a Asar B'Tishrei, which was the 10th of Tishrei. So again, because remember, he was up there for 40 days, and then the Cheid Eagle, that's on the 17th of Tammuz, and then he goes back up, and he davens, and then he gets told to make another set. Let's see how he breaks it down. Va'oso Ayom Nemar, and on the 10th of Tishrei, which was Yom Kippur, that's the day that God says to Moshe Rabbeinu, Vayinochem Hashem al Maisa Ego, that Hashem finally decides to forgive Bnei Yisrael for the sin of the golden calf. But also, Ayom Omar Lo, on that day, the 10th of Tishrei, that's when God says to Moshe, Salachti Kibarecha, I have forgiven you, just like you've asked. But also, Ayom, and also on that day, Namar Lo, Hashem says to Moshe, Vasuli Mikdash, Meshachanti Mitzacham, build for me a Mikdash and I'll dwell in your midst. That's a busy Yom Kippur. That's when Hashem says to Moshe again that I've decided to forgive Bnei Yisrael, Salachti Kibarecha, and also Vasuli Mikdash, build for me a sanctuary. Ubo Bayom Amarlo. And on that same day, meaning on that Yom Kippur, the 10th of Tishrei, which is why it was designated Yom Kippur for all generations. So on that day, what happens? That Hashem will forgive us. Hayom azet tanchilenu slicho darot, designated for forgiveness for all generations. Uvo vayom, and on that same day, on Yom Kippur, Amar lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu, ki bayom azet yichaper aleichem. This is the day that I will forgive you every year on the calendar. Vasu es hamishkan bechedva uvesimcha. And that's why they start the project of the Mishkan with a great sense of rejoicing, an incredible sense of happiness. Ulekama chadoshim nigmara melachas hamishkan. So new, how many months did it take to build the Mishkan? Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachman Amar b'shlosha chadoshim nigmara melachas hamishkan. It took the whole project, took Bnei Yisrael 3 months between the collection, which was a matter of days, and then fashioning all the items into the kalim and into the structure of the Mishkan, it took a total of 3 months. Tishrei, Mar Cheshvan, and Kislev. Because again, remember, it was given to them, the order comes down on the 10th of Tishrei, that's Yom Kippur, they start the project. So they've got from Tishrei through Mar Cheshvan and Kislev, other sources say it ends on the 25th of Kislev. So Munach Mefurak Teves Ushvat Adar. The Mishkan was totally finished. It was assembled, but it remained folded up, meaning it was intentionally not assembled for 3 months. It was intentionally not assembled for 3 months for Teves, Shvat, and Adar. The Amidu, and when was it finally set up? Be'echad b'Nisan, on the first day of Nisan. Shenemar, because the Torah says, Be'yom HaChodesh HaRishon, And the first month, the first day, Takimas Mishkan Oel Moed. That's when they finally set it up. So again, what do we have so far? Moshe Rabbeinu was up on Har Sinai for three periods of 40 days, a total of 120 days. And what happens at the end is Yom Kippur. On Yom Kippur, that's when Hashem tells Moshe, I've forgiven you. I will forgive you year in and year out on this day. And also, Vasuli Mikdash. They immediately begin the project of the Mishkan, and it lasts for 3 months. So they're done with the Mishkan towards the end of Kislev. But now there's 3 months, Teves, Shvat, and Adar, where the Mishkan just sat, gathering dust. They did not set it up till Nisan. There was a 3-month waiting period. Now, Medrash continues, Lama lo amad miyad. If it was finished at the end of Kislev, why did Hashem, in his infinite wisdom, say, I wanted to sit and gather dust for Teves, Shvat, and Adar for 3 months? Why didn't they just set it up right away? Why was it so important to delay everything till Nisan? Elam ipnei shechashav HaKadosh Baruch Hu larev simchas hamishkan b'simchas hayom shenolad lavo Yitzhak Avinu. Hashem, in his infinite wisdom, wanted to mix the joy of the celebration of setting up the Mishkan with the joy that Bnei Yisrael feels of the month of Nisan, because that's when Yitzchak Avinu was born. Lefisha b'Nisan nolad Yitzchak. Yitzchak was born in Nisan. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God says, Hareini ma'arev simchaschem, simcha b'simcha. God says, I'm going to do something so awesome. I'm going to combine these two incredible simchas. There's something so special about Nisan. That's the month that Yitzchak Avinu was born. So I'm going to delay the construction, the erection of the Mishkan until Nisan. That way we'll be able to combine these two incredible forms of happiness. That's what the Medrash tells us. But what we know for a fact is as follows. The Mishkan was finished at the end of Kislev, and it was not set up until Nisan. That means three entire months, Teves, Shvat, and Adar, the Mishkan is sitting gathering dust. That's what we know. So now I want to share with you an incredible, beautiful, beautiful thought that I heard from Rabbi Bronstein this past Shabbos. Last Shabbos was Kisisa. Kisisa is the parsha where the Cheda Egel takes place. He said that the Mishkan is a kapara. The Mishkan, the building of the Mishkan is an atonement for the Maisa Ego. And it's a testimony. It's Eidos. Why? Because once God's presence rests there, that's clear testimony that God, we're still his people. He's dwelling in our midst. But what is it about the Mishkan? How does it serve? How did it serve as a kapara? How did it serve as an atonement? I understand the Eidos. It's testimony that God's forgiven us. Yeah, because his presence is in our midst. He obviously forgave us. But how was it a kapara? How was it that it atoned? What was it about the building of the Mishkan that served, so to say, atone for what we did wrong? And Rabbi Bronstein quoted a following idea. Look what happened. Look what was at the root of the Cheda Egel. I've got a pasuk here from last week's Parsha. In Shmos Lamed Beis 32, it says Aleph, Vayar ha'am ki boshesh Moshe loredes min ahar. Everybody saw that Moshe delayed in coming down from the mountain. Vayikahel ha'am, there's that word. Vayikahel ha'am al Aaron. So now everyone gathered up. They ganged up on Aaron. Vayomru elav, and they said to him, Kuma selanu Elohim. Now we need you to make for us a God, Asher yelchu lefaneinu, that'll go before us. Kizeh Moshe ha'ish, Asher ha'alanu meretz Mitzrayim lo yadanam elo. We don't know what happened to Moshe. So Rabbi Bronstein quoted a source, and this was in a footnote of the Sefer called Otsros Pinine HaTorah, that he has the following idea, and this makes so much sense. What was at the root of the problem here? The Klal Yisrael thought Moshe was going to come down. They're looking at their watches, they're looking at their calendars. Moshe's not there. He told us he was going to be up there for 40 days, and they miscalculated. And what do they immediately do? They immediately start to demand Aaron builds this Egel Azav to build this God with a lowercase g, something to lead them, because they can't be without a leader. Why didn't they just give it another day? Say, maybe we miscalculated. There was a lack of patience. There was a lack of savlanus. There was a lack of patience. They were acting with such impetuousness, impatience, that they were just jumping the gun. And that was what was at the root of the Cheda Egel. If Klal Yisrael would have just had a little bit more patience, Aaron says to him, Chag Lashem Machar. Okay, he was delaying them. He says, yeah, we'll make a big celebration tomorrow. Aaron understood patience, but Klal Yisrael didn't. What was at the root of the problem of the Egel was people didn't know how to wait. So many times in life, we get ourselves into problems because we don't have patience. We have questions and I need an answer now. I need something now. And because I don't have something immediate, I get into problems. We're so used to needing this fix that we need for immediacy. If we could just learn to be a little bit more patient, we wouldn't have many problems. So that's what's at the root of this Cheda Egel. The Cheda Egel, at the root of the Cheda Egel, is we didn't have patience. How is the Mishkan a kapara for the Cheda Egel? Mishkan taught B'nai Yisrael patience, because look what happened. They collected everything they needed within a matter of days. They start building. In 3 months, it's finished. By Chaf Hei Kislev, they were finished. They could have assembled the Mishkan. Every single morning, Klal Yisrael approaches Moshe Rabbeinu and they say, "No, can we move on?" Moshe says, "Wait. What do you mean? We're waiting to hear from Hashem." It goes on another day. Is today the day? I'm waiting to hear from Hashem. for 3 months. Could you imagine what those 3 months were like? Teves, Shavat, and Adar. Every single morning, Klal Yisrael is banging on Moshe's door. Is today the day? And Moshe says, we got to wait. We're waiting for Hashem's instruction. Every single day, all of Klal Yisrael is saying, no, we just invested an incredible amount of money, time, energy, resources. And we want to see that God's still in our midst because the guilt is gnawing at us about the Chet HaEgel. And every single day, they're told what? Savlanus, have some patience. For 3 months, they're chomping at the bit. And Moshe says, patience, slow down. Finally, comes Nisan, Hashem says, yeah, now's the time because this is the month that Yitzchak was born. That's what I was waiting for. Let's set up that Mishkan. And on the first day of Nisan, they finally set it up. For 3 months, Bnei Yisrael exhibited the character trait that they were so sorely lacking that caused the Chet HaEgel. For 3 months, Bnei Yisrael said, we'll hold our horses. We're not in control. We'd like things to run according to our schedule, but that's not happening. We're going to have to wait. For 3 months, Bnei Yisrael was forced to wait, and that was a correction of that midah. That was a correction of that character trait, that they were so impatient. The Mishkan taught them to be patient because the project was finished. And for 3 months, they sat there. You know, you could just imagine. I mean, think about the times in life that we've been so impatient and being told to sit on something for 3 months, go out of our minds. That's exactly what Klal Yisrael was put through for those 3 months. That's where they learned to be patient. That's how the Mishkan is suggested in the Sefer, Otzeros Panini HaTorah. That's the suggestion, how the Mishkan's a kapara, how the Mishkan atones for the Chet HaEgel. That root of the Chet HaEgel was caused by our jumping the gun, our not knowing how to be patient. The Mishkan taught us to be patient because it was ready 3 months earlier. Every day we're demanding of Moshe Nu. He says, we're waiting for Hashem. We act on his say. And then that's what taught Klal Yisrael to be patient. I thought this was beautiful. So look what this does. The Pasuk tells us that it's the Mishkan Eidus. It testifies to the fact that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has forgiven us for the Chet HaEgel because His Shechina is in our midst. His divine presence is in our midst. Beautiful. How? How exactly was it? So we saw Rav Shlomo Kluger that told us that Moshe chose his words in Vayakel, in our week's Parsha this week. But Moshe chose words that he was choosing to be mesaken. He was doing a tikkun on those words. Bnei Yisrael used the word vayakel or vayikahel. It's the same word at the Chet HaEgel. He says, we're going to fix that. Use the word eila involving the Chet HaEgel. We're going to fix that. Use the word zeh in the Chet HaEgel. We're going to fix that. All those words that played an integral role in the Chet HaEgel, we're going to now use those same words in the construction of the Mishkan. That's a tikkun. But in the bigger picture, how was the Mishkan such a kapara for the Chet HaEgel? This is this idea from this Otzros Panine HaTorah, that the whole, at the root of the Chet HaEgel was this problem. We didn't know how to be patient. The Mishkan taught us to be patient because it was ready 3 months before Nisan. It was ready. It was ready at Chafei Kislev, where we celebrate Hanukkah. You know, there's sources that say that's why Hashem put the holiday of Hanukkah in Kislev as a way to, so to say, pay back Kislev. Feel bad because the Mishkan really could have gone up in Kislev, but Hashem decides to wait till Nisan because that's when Yitzchak was born. So Nu, what are we going to do for Kislev? Gave it Hanukkah. That's what there's sources that tell us that. But for 3 months, we were ready to build the Mishkan. And Moshe says, sit, hold your horses, sit down. Don't. There's no rush. We act when Hashem tells us to act. That forces Bnei Yisrael to exhibit patience, learn to be patient. Now we understand how the Mishkan could be a kapara for the Chet HaEgel, getting to the root cause of what was behind that Chet HaEgel and seeing what can we do to correct that. I thought that this was incredible, beautiful about the two sides of the coin of seeing words that were used for the Chet. Now we're going to use those same words with the construction of Mishkan. This midah that was so lacking, character trait that was so lacking, that led to the Chet HaEgel. Now we're going to correct that midah in the construction of the Mishkan. Now we understand that it's not just the Mishkan HaEdos, it doesn't just give testimony, but the process involved in constructing the Mishkan was a kapara, was a true atonement for what had gone wrong on a national level in the building of the golden calf and the Egel Hazah. I thought that was very, very cool. All right, let's move on. Dvar Torah number 2. Vartara number two is a beautiful idea I saw based on a Das Zakenim. This is a very similar idea we once mentioned elsewhere in Sefer Bereishis, but I saw it this year for the first time in this Das Zakenim, and it's worth it to share. Look at this. So the Pasuk tells us about Bezalel. The Pasuk says as follows, Vayomer Moshe al Bnei Yisrael. Moshe says, this is not the first time Bezalel is introduced. You'll see on the lower down on the page, we have Bezalel was introduced a couple weeks earlier. It says in Shmos Lamed Aleph, Vayidaber Hashem al Moshe Lemor, Rei Karasi B'Shem Bezalel ben Uri ben Hur l'Matei Yehuda. Then Hashem tells Moshe, I've called upon Bezalel, who's the son of Uri, the son of Hur, so he's the grandson of Hur. And by the way, who is Hur? Hur was the son of Miriam and Kalev. So this is a grandson of Hur, which would make him a great-grandson of Miriam. So Lamate Yehuda, and he's in Sheva Yehuda, because again, Miriam's husband was Kalev ben Yefuna. So here's what we, that's what we have. Okay, so that was the first time Bezalel shows up. Bezalel shows up in our Parsha this week as well. So let's go back up. I'm on page 3. So Pasuk says as follows in Shmos Lamed Hey 35. Vayomer Moshe al Bnei Yisrael Lemor. Bnei Yisrael, Moshe says to the Jewish people, Ru kara Hashem b'shem Bezalel ben Uri ben Hur l'mate Yehuda. So again, remember, Hashem says, see, Ru, see, that Hashem has called upon Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, from the tribe of Yehuda, to be the chief artisan involved and in charge of building the Mishkan. That's what we are told. And again, if Bezalel's grandfather was Hur, so then his great grandmother was Miriam. Okay, let's see the Das Zakenim. Re'u Kara. So he's going on Re'u Kara. Moshe says, Re'u, see. He says to Bnei Yisrael, see that Hashem has chosen, is called upon Bezalel. Ma'u Re'u? What's the Torah? Why is this word Re'u, see? It's an extra word. What's this doing here? L'fisha k'sha'amar Moshe li'Yisrael, when Moshe originally told the Jewish people in Perek Lamed Aleph that we have below, Shebetzal Yasa Mishkan, when Moshe originally told everyone Betzal is going to be the man in charge of building the Mishkan, Hoyu Yisrael Meranin in Acharei Moshe, Bnei Yisrael started to scoff at Moshe and started to kind of quibble with him. Vormim, and they said, Shekola Gdulu, Nota Lo Mishpachto. Look at this guy. It's very similar to the Korach line. This nepotism. He says he's taking all the positions of prominence and he's given them to family members because Bezalel is Miriam's great-grandson. So that means he's like a great nephew of Moshe. He's all in the family. So he's related to Moshe through his sister Miriam. Hey, look at what he's doing, this guy. So there was nudniks who were giving Moshe a hard time about appointing Bezalel. Amar la Moshe. So Moshe says, okay, we got to settle this down. I want you to know and I want you to see. I'm not doing this on my own. I'm doing this because God has instructed me to call upon Bezalel. When Hashem said to him the instructions about building the Mishkan, God said the term v'asisa, and you should make. Moshe initially thought, oh boy, Hashem's telling me I've got to be the chief artisan. That's not necessarily my skill. Amar lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God says to him, no. Lo kasher ola b'daitcha. It's not what you're thinking. Elet tzadik shener agal maisa ego. That tzadik, meaning Hur, dahinu Hur. Hur was a tzadik who was killed. There was a real insurrection. When Bnei Yisrael were trying to build the ego, Hur was the son of Miriam, believed Moshe's coming back, and this is a terrible mistake. So we're told in the Midrashim that Hur tried to stop them, and they killed Hur. So Elat Sadik Shenerag al Maisa Egel, that Sadik who was killed because of the construction of the Egel, Dainu Hur, Yavo Ben Beno V'yasenu. It's only fitting that his grandson, because again, Bezalel was the son of Uri, the son of Hur. So Bezalel is his grandson. It's only fitting that his grandson should come and build it. L'fisha Mishkan Kapara Alo Samaisa. Since the Mishkan, here's that theme again, the Mishkan is supposed to be a kapara, an atonement for that maisa, for that terrible chait, that terrible sin of the golden calf. So it's only appropriate that since it's coming to atone for the golden calf, it's only appropriate that Hur, who was killed during the chait of the ego, someone from his flesh and blood should have a hand in the construction of the Mishkan. Hur was all about trying to stop the ego. So it's only fitting that the Mishkan, which is coming to serve as a kapara, as an atonement for the ego, someone from Chur's family should have a handle, should have a hand in this. So therefore, he says it's important that Bezalel should play this role. Lefisha Mishkan kapara losa maisa, because it's an atonement for this. V'zeh shamar lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that's why Hashem says to Moshe, Re'ei Karasi. So again, look at in Lamed Aleph, that Hashem says to Moshe, Re'ei Karasi, see that I have called. And then in this pasuk here in Lamed Hey, Moshe says, Re'u, he says to Bnei Israel, you should see. Whenever that expression Re'ei is used, or Re'u, that's all the same word, see. See what that denotes is, what it connotes is, that I'm going to explain this to you. I'm not just saying something to you. I'm going to tell you the backstory. So that's the same idea. Hashem says to Moshe, Re'ei, I'm going to explain to you why I'm asking Bezalel to step into this role. So to hear when Moshe is saying to Bnei Yisrael, Re'u, see, what Moshe is saying is, I'm going to explain to you why Bezalel is chosen for this role. It's not because of nepotism. It's because he's the grandson of Chur. And since Chur was killed in the Maisa Egel, the construction Egel, it's only fitting that his grandson should be involved in the Kapara, in the atonement of it. So that's what Re'ei connotes. Re'ei means I'm going to explain to you what's going on here. I'm not just issuing a command. I'm not just saying, do what I say it is. Just follow orders. That's not what Re'u, that's not what Re'ei. That Re'ei means I'm going to explain. I'm not just saying, follow my orders. So I think there's a beautiful idea here from the Das of Canaan. Moshe Rabbeinu, with all of his authority and with all of his position that he had, he still felt the need to say, Re'u, I'm going to explain this to you. And where did he get this lesson from? Hashem Yisparach, God Almighty himself. When Hashem told Moshe to appoint Bezalel, Hashem also says, Re'ei, see, I'm going to explain this to you. It's not a good idea when we're in a position of leadership and we're asking people to fall in line and to follow through. It's not a good idea to try to run the show by just saying, follow my orders. The best way to get buy-in, the best way to make certain that we have everybody's agreement is to explain ourselves. It might work when we're dealing with little children that we'll just say, just do that because I said so. That may work when you're dealing with a little kid. That may work when you're dealing with a baby and you're telling him to eat his, you know, to drink his milk, whatever it may be. But when you're dealing with someone who's a thinking, breathing, thinking person, and they want to understand what's going on around them, especially if something doesn't look right, the best approach to take is the Re'u approach. Let me explain this to you. Don't ask people to just go through life taking orders. It doesn't work well. People are thinking human beings. And as thinking human beings, we want to understand the world around us, and we want to understand decisions being made around us. And if someone is being asked to fill a certain role, we want to explain to people why I'm choosing A and I didn't choose B and I didn't choose you. And I'm going to explain, and I'm far more likely to have buy-in and to have agreement and to have shalom if I go through life explaining myself than if I go through life just saying, follow my instructions. It doesn't work well. I think that's a beautiful idea from this Das of Canaan here. Hashem exhibited that when he told Moshe, Re'ei. And Moshe's following Hashem's lead when he's telling Klal Yisrael, Re'u. He doesn't just say, follow my instructions. He says, I'm going to explain it to you. I think there's a lesson there for every one of us, whether it's as parents to our children, teachers to our students, rabbis to our shul members, whatever it is, we're making a big mistake if we're just going through life telling people, just follow my instructions. I need to explain. I need to let people understand that there's a reason behind what it is that I'm doing. That's Dvar Torah number two. And finally, Dvar Torah number three, I want to share with you a beautiful idea I saw in a Meshech Chachma this week from Rav Meir Simcha Cohen of Dvinsk. So let's see. This is something I never really noticed before. But towards the end of the Parsha, after everything is being built, it's being brought to Moshe to show we did what we were asked to do. You wanted this item built, boom, here it is. You wanted this item built for the Mishkan, here it is. And they're being brought to Moshe one at a time. There's a discrepancy, which I never noticed until this year. Let me share it with you. Perek Lamed Zayin, 37. Vayas Bezalel es Aaron. Bezalel built the Aaron. tells us it was Atzei Shittim. At its core, it was acacia wood, and it gives us the dimensions, and it was covered with gold. Skipping to Pasuk Yud. Vayas es ha-shulchan. And he made the shulchan, that special table that would have the lechma panim on it. Then Tezayin, 16. Vayas es ha-kelim asher al ha-shulchan. He built all the tools that were going to be on the table. Skip to 17. Yudzayin. Vayas es ha-menorah. He built the golden menorah. And Chafei, 25. Vayas es mizbeach haktoras. He built the golden mizbeach. And finally, 29, Chaftes, Vayasis, Shemin HaMishcha, he made the special oil for anointing. There's more times this comes up as well. I just took out these. But do you see what the discrepancy is? By all the Kalim, by everything that was constructed, it just says Vayas, Vayas, Vayas. Only by the Aron in Pasuk Aleph, at the bottom of page 3, only there does it say Vayas Bitsalo as Aron. Bitsalo is the overseer of everything that was built in the Mishkan. But the only item that gets his name attached to it is which? The Aron that contained the Luchos. All the other items, it says Vayas, he built, he made. It says that by all the other items, but the only one that's got his signature, so to say, that has his name forever attached to it in the Torah is the Aron. That can't be a coincidence. I never saw anyone make this observation before. It's an awesome observation. Never caught my attention. I want to share with you a very brief comment from the Meshech Chachma. And here's how he explains it. The Meshech Chachma, again, is written by Rav Meir Simcha Cohen of Dvinsk at pretty much the turn of the 20th century in Dvinsk in Latvia. So here's what he writes. Vayas Bitzalel es ha'aron. Bitzalel made the aron. Madaloksin b'chulu Bitzalel. By nothing else does Bezalel's name appear. Everything else, this is Vayas es ha-menorah. He made the menorah, he made the shulchan, he made the shemen ha-mishcha, all that stuff, made the golden mizbech, everything. The only one that you see, Vayas Bezalel, that Bezalel made is by the Aron. What's going on here? Why specifically there? So look what the Meshech Chachma says. Madalok sim the kulu Bezalel. Why does it not say Bezalel's name by everything else? It only says it by the Aron. Mishum shishara dvarim asu gam acherim beis olamim. Because when the Beis HaMikdash is built, they built new ones, and they made new ones for the Beis HaMikdash. B'chein b'bayis sheni, and also in the second Beis HaMikdash, they made a new shulchan, they made a new golden mizbeach, they made a new menorah. In fact, Shlomo HaMelech built several menorahs. They made everything else they made. The only item that was never replicated, that was never rebuilt, was the Aron. That's amazing. Also with the second base of Mikdash, Ula Asir, and in the future, meaning the third base of Mikdash. When the third base of Mikdash that we daven for every single day, multiple times in the course of the day, when that third base of Mikdash is rebuilt, it should happen b'mehera b'yameinu. When that third base of Mikdash is rebuilt, all the items will be built. Maybe those guys in Machon HaMikdash in Yerushalayim that they're studying this, and maybe they'll have a hand in building that. Who knows who's going to build it? But there's one item that'll never be built, and Bezalel's is going to be the original. And that's the Aron. Avla Aron, but the Aron, the original Aron, Mishenignaz, when it was squirreled away, when it was hidden away by Yoshiyahu HaMelech, he hid it towards the end of the destruction, towards the end of the first Beis HaMikdash. Before it was going to be destroyed, Yoshiyahu HaMelech was gonez. He hid away the Aron. Lo asu acher, they never built a replica. They didn't have in the second base of Mikdash a aron that was built as best to the dimensions as it could. They didn't have such a thing. Ki ein lasos luchos acher, because you can't make a second set of luchos. There's only one set of luchos. Remember, the aron contained the luchos. It had the shivrei luchos, the broken luchos from the first set, and it had the second set of luchos that Moshe Rabbeinu got from HaKadosh Baruch Hu Har Sinai. But that's it. We can't make another set of luchos. Barak Aron Bitzalel hu shekayim ledoros velo acher. There's only one Aron that'll last and that will always serve in that functions for all eternity. And that's it. That's why Bitzalel's name appears by the Aron, because that's the only one that'll never be replicated. And when the Beis HaMikdash is rebuilt and Hashem lets us know where the Aron is and it'll be placed in there again, that's going to be the original Aron of Bitzalel that will be there. That's why Bitzalel's name appears in this. Yes, for the Mishkan, he constructed everything. But the remez, the hint that's being told to us in the Torah here is that, yes, he may have built everything, but there will come a time where the Beis HaMikdash is going to be built. The first Beis HaMikdash. And for whatever reason, Shlomo HaMelech wants a bigger one, wants more menorahs, wants more shulchans. He did that too. He wants another Mizbech Hazav. You can build another one. That's not a problem. And when the second Beis HaMikdash is built, certainly all that stuff is new. They didn't have the original ones. That was all sacked when the first Beis HaMikdash was destroyed. There's only one item that'll never be rebuilt, and that'll never be another replica of that made, and that is the original Aron. That original Aron was the only Aron because it contains the Luchos, and there's not going to be another set of Luchos. So that original Aron is Bezalel's, and it was put away towards the end of the first Beis HaMikdash by Yoshio HaMelech, and we did not have it at all during the second Beis HaMikdash. But when the third Beis HaMikdash is rebuilt, b'mehirah b'yameinu, and Hashem reveals to us the location of that Aron, and we reclaim it, and we have it back again, we'll have it. And that's Bezalel's Aron. And that's why the name Bezalel only appears by the Aron, to let us know that's the only item that that cannot be replicated, will always have to be the original. And God willing, when the Beis HaMikdash is rebuilt soon, we will have that original Aron back again. God willing, that should all happen again soon. So those are three divrei Torah for Parshas Vayakel. Again, the first one all had to do with the concept of the Mishkan serving as a kapara, as an atonement for the Cheda Ego. Dvar Torah number two was a bit different. Dvar Torah number two had to do with Bezalel and the fact that Hashem used the word Re'u and Re'eh by Bezalel, telling us, and Moshe used that word too, telling us that the smart approach in life is not just to say to people, follow my orders, but to explain why it is we're asking them to do what we're asking of them, or the decisions, the choices that we've made, that'll be far more successful for people to swallow in the long run. And Dvar Torah number three, something very unique about the Aron in distinction to all the other Kalim in the Mishkan and later in the Beis HaMikdash. I'm going to stop the recording.